Well, I don't know if you're going to praise him all day long, but you ought to start right now. Yes, God. Look down your row and tell him, I'm going to start right now. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. The Lord is great. And he is greatly to be praised. Y'all remain standing. We're going to get into the word of God and go home. This is my story. I don't care nothing about what's going on out there right now. I'm praising my Savior. Anybody got a story? Anybody got a song? All the day long. Now, last Sunday was First Fruit Sunday. My wife and I stood at this altar. Service started at 12:30 on Sunday. My wife and I stood at this altar and we laid hands and spoke over every person's life who wanted that to be done. The service started at 12:30. The last person that we laid hands on was 1:30 a.m. Monday morning. 1:30 a.m. Monday morning. And anytime you do that, virtue leaves you and you're just tired. And came back to work the next day and we've been laboring. So today, I have the opportunity to receive today. Amen. I have the opportunity just to receive today. I've got a great man of God. You should celebrate him. And the reason, amen. I was called to preach in 1992. I was called to preach in 1992. I didn't say I started preaching in 1990. I said I got called in 1992. I let the phone ring for a while. And finally picked up and the Lord really just began to use me, but in small circles, and I had a lot to learn. I had a zeal for God. It just wasn't according to knowledge, and the first full-time ministry opportunity that I was given to be paid to preach and share the gospel and pastor was in 1995, doing college ministry through a college ministry called InterVarsity Christian Fellowship. I learned more in those years with InterVarsity Christian Fellowship than I've ever learned in life. I learned how to develop ministry and to create prayer circles and to study the Bible and to teach people how to study the Bible and to love people. And so you have learned and you have benefited from that teaching that I was taught in InterVarsity Christian Fellowship. That was done through Bruce Allwood, who was my supervisor at that time, who was my boss at that time, taught me everything I needed to know about ministry. So if you think that we are a ministry of prayer or worship or we care and love people, it's because this man poured that into my life. And so this is a harvest of seeds that you placed inside. He is no longer working for InterVarsity Christian Fellowship. He is now a missionary. He and his beautiful wife are missionaries doing the same thing, pouring into pastors in Ireland. In Ireland. And so when I was in Ireland last year, I was preaching for him in Ireland. And so I was in Ireland, and they do everything different. I felt weird the whole time I was there. So that's what you get today. Amen. Amen. So in Ireland, after you get finished preaching, The Amber Bears don't bring you water. They bring you a Michelob or Coors Light or something. I said, no, we don't do that, baby. We don't do that. See, some of y'all are about to get you a ticket to Ireland. Like, you better join the Ireland church. Yeah, they drinking and talking about Jesus. I said, now, that's weird. Am I lying? I'm right. No. That's the truth. Like, we having Bible study where? We having it at the pub. At the pub? Yeah. Bruce, like, no, you don't get anybody coming to Bible study unless you have beer. Are you crazy? don't go get no passport. That's what I'm trying to say to you. So I thank God for this great man of God. This is minister. What's your? You don't do no title. This is Bruce Allwood and his beautiful wife, Kathy, has mentored my wife for years, and his family is with him. Would you thank God for me and with me for a great gift that the Lord has given this body and the person of Bruce Allwood and his beautiful family? Y'all ain't doing nothing. I don't know what y'all do. Preach, man. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for this great man of God. I thank you for the word of God that's about to be preached. The people of God, they're about to be attentive to it. Somebody's going to be blessed. Somebody's going to be healed. Somebody's going to be delivered. Somebody's going to be set free because of the revelation that is coming from this great man of God. We thank you, and we call it done in Jesus' name. Amen. Somebody give God a praise right now. Love you, man.
Wow, you guys can be seated. I'm not sure if it's the second quarter or halftime or the third quarter. I love it. I've already changed my sermon title since the service has started to God is everything. God was everything to David. We're going to talk a little bit about King David today. I did want to, I mean, you guys know the gift you have in Pastor and Lady Arnold, and I'm not going to tell a whole bunch of stories today on my brother here, but I will say, I want to just let you in on a little secret. You know, we had Daryl over last spring to the Republic of Ireland, put him in a car with an Irish pastor, drove 4 hours north to the Irish coast up there, and the town of Derry, to the hardcore Irish, Londonderry for kind of the British Irish folks, and put him in front of 150 folks, Catholics, Methodists, Presbyterians, Pentecostals, the Church of Ireland, to speak to a group of people who have been at enmity with each other for decades, Catholic, Protestant, on the issue of reconciliation and forgiveness, out of Daryl's own experience. And the crazy thing is, you know, sometimes when white folks ask black preachers to preach, we'll say, take 30 minutes, and we know they'll take an hour. Or we'll say, 10 minutes, and we know they'll take 30. This is one of those cases where I had to say to your pastor, you have 12 minutes and the mic will be cut. And I'm here to tell you that pastor can deliver a powerful message in only 12 minutes. So, yeah, do with that information what you want. I'll just let you take that. So this morning, we are in Psalm chapter 3. Psalm chapter 3. If you have your Bibles, it'd be good to have them out. And then I think we'll have a few slides here as well to follow along. Psalm chapter 3, which has 8 verses. But I want to start with verse 5 to kind of kick us off here, because this is going to be the anchor for us as we work our way through this psalm this morning. Verse 5, I lie down and sleep. I wake again because I set my alarm. No, I wake again because I take care of my body through good fitness and nutritional habits. I wake again because I'm well fed. I wake again because I've got a great job. See, I wake again because I'm only 57 and I haven't reached the average life expectancy of age 78 yet. I wake again because I think I'm in control of my life. No, 1,000 times no. What does David say? I wake again because the Lord sustains me. Do you sleep well at night? I mean, when you go to bed, are you able to set aside all the cares of the day, the worries of tomorrow, all the loose ends that never seem to get tied up, and just enter into this deep and peaceful sleep? I mean, there's some issues that are out of your control, like, you know, spouses that snore. Spouses that take up more than their fair share of the bed. Babies that cry in the night. Sounds of the city, trucks on the interstate, emergency vehicles rushing by, late night parties with broken glass, loud conversations out your window. But as much as you can control, is your heart at peace when you turn out the light? Call it a day. Go to bed. I mean, sleep, what an amazing thing. Do you sleep well at night? See, when David slept, he slept in peace. The very next psalm, Psalm 4, verse 8 says, "In peace I will lie down and sleep, for you alone, Lord, make me dwell in safety." See, when David went to sleep, it was with the full assurance that Almighty God's in control, even of his waking the next morning. I mean, many of us are familiar with the old bedtime prayer that we did with our kids, you know, based on, I think it came out of the 18th century. "Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take." I mean, a childhood prayer for many of us, but it's actually quite profound. It's just it's often repeated in kind of a perfunctory way, you know, with minimum effort, little reflection, but not so for David. See, David believed, he trusted, he had faith that the Lord was keeping his soul and that life was sustained by God on a daily basis. He didn't just think it in his head. This wasn't lip service to the truth or what I like to call situational believism. You know what situational believism is? It's believing in God's power when you're comfortable and when you're not in crisis. But David had found a way to lie down and go to sleep in the full assurance that his life, including his ability to breathe, was in the hands of God. Almighty God had offered David the grace of dependency, a life of complete dependency on God's sovereignty, on his power, on his faithfulness, on his love toward him. And David had received this grace in his life, even to the full extent of depending on God to number his days. David was sustained and rested in the grace of Almighty God. How did David do this? This is the fundamental question I'm going to ask you this morning, because I want to sleep like David did. Well, David must have had an easy life. That's how he did it. He didn't have a hard life like you and me. I mean, he must have had everything under control, not out of control lives like we have. I mean, how else could he have turned his mind off and rested in the sustaining grace of Almighty God? I think we all know David actually had a very difficult life. David was sleeping in the midst of severe persecution and opposition. Look here at back now at the very beginning of this psalm. It actually starts with this superscript, a psalm of David when he fled from his son Absalom. Emphasis on son. It's not just this person Absalom he's fleeing from, it's his flesh and blood, his son. And if we had time, we'd do a nice Bible study in 2 Samuel chapters 13 to 17, and you will read and learn about the sad story of Absalom and his father David. It began when Absalom's brother Amnon and had this unhealthy, wrong kind of love toward his half-sister Tamar. Did any of you guys ever see the movie Gladiator? It's my favorite. Where Commodus, you know, is in love with his half-sister Lucille, kind of a sick kind of love. It's the same kind of thing here. Amnon is in love with his half-sister Tamar, and it ends up in him raping his sister. A couple years later, Absalom then murders his own brother in front of all the other brothers. So Absalom and his father become estranged from each other for many, many years. And then they have kind of a partial reconciliation. David invites him back to Jerusalem, but tells him he has to stay quarantined in a particular house. Finally, Absalom gets a face-to-face meeting with his father, and it kind of results in an uneasy alliance, but Absalom begins to be kind of this self-judge for all the Israelites out by the city gate. And it begins to kind of develop into a conspiracy. A conspiracy for him to take the kingdom from his father. David has to flee the city. And as humiliation, I mean, and he's leaving the city, he's weeping, he's barefoot. His head is covered as his own flesh and blood enters the city. And on the road out of the city, David is ridiculed by a guy named Shimei. And he throws stones and curses and makes indictments and insults. He says, David, God's punishing you for your wicked and murderous ways. And David laments, my son, who's my own flesh, is trying to take my life. Absalom eventually leads a huge army of thousands and thousands of Israelites to go kill and destroy his father. This is Psalm 3. This is the context here when David went to bed one night in a dark and lonely cave in exile. David, the anointed king of Israel, having fled Jerusalem because of his son's conspiracy to become king and murder his father, finds himself huddled in a dark, damp, lonely cave, lays his head down to sleep, and writes this psalm. And beginning in verse 1, says, Lord, how they have increased who trouble me. How many are my foes? Many are they who rise up against me. Tens of thousands assail me on every side. Many are they who say of me, there's no help for him in God. God will not deliver him. David is facing many enemies. I mean, ultimately it's Absalom, but it includes Absalom's army. It includes many, many Israelites, people of Israel, his own flesh and blood, along with the people of his kingdom, have become his enemies. I mean, David's situation is so bad, God cannot even help him. God will not deliver him. Is there any greater place of despair or hopelessness? I mean, listen to these words in 2 Samuel by Shimei, straight from the text, chapter 16, verses 5 to 8. As King David approached Bahurim, a man from the same clan as Saul's family came out from there. His name was Shimei, and he cursed as he came out. He pelted David, all the king's officials, with stones. And all the troops in the special guard were on David's right and left. And as he cursed, Shimei said, get out, you murderer, you scoundrel. The Lord's repaid you for all the blood you shed in the household of Saul, in whose place you had reigned. The Lord has given the kingdom into the hands of your son Absalom, and you have come to ruin because you are a murderer. Wow. I mean, the impact of those words of curses and indictments and ridicule cannot be overstated. God's against him. God's giving David what he deserves. This accusation may have been the most painful of all for David during this exile from Absalom. The thought that God might be against him. The thought that there's no help for him in God. Charles Spurgeon, an English Baptist preacher back in the 19th century, offers the following reflection on this final phrase, there's no help for him in God, in verse 2. From Spurgeon, if all the trials which come from heaven, all the temptations which ascend from hell, and all the crosses which arise from the earth could be mixed and pressed together, they would not make a trial so terrible as that which is contained in this verse. It's the most bitter of all afflictions to be led to fear that there is no help for us in God. These are the opening words of this traumatic and emotive psalm, where David is naming his enemies and the impact of their accusatory words. David is tempted to believe in despair that God will not help him. Are you here this morning tempted to despair? Facing and likely fearing enemies, external, internal, fighting demons, in conflict with those close to you, anxious about world events, misunderstood, taken advantage of, suffering in body, mind, or heart, carrying feelings of self-pity, victimization, injustice, loneliness, sadness. Name it. We all have stories of despair and lament and suffering and difficult. Life is hard. And we all have enemies. Death is my biggest enemy. Specifically facing untimely deaths. Untimely deaths are my biggest temptation to despair. Shrivel up into a shell and echo the words of Shemaiah that God will not deliver his people, Bruce. I'm tempted to believe that God's of no help in light of the enemy of untimely deaths. In the last 6 years, I've experienced too many untimely deaths. Loved ones, friends, and colleagues. 3 years ago, my 23-year-old daughter calls us across the land, across the Atlantic in Ireland, with the news that her best friend for life had dropped dead of complications with type 1 diabetes. With uncontrollable sobbing, she doesn't know how to tell us the news. At age 24, her friend is dead. Senseless. A life that offered so much to this world. What do you do with that news? I cried. I wept. I questioned God's sovereignty, his control of things, his love, his very presence. I wrote a lengthy tribute to Paige's friend as a means of expressing my lament. But I didn't want to leave my lament. I wanted to stay there, absorbed in this place of hopelessness. I had enough of death. I felt piled on by God. It was just a couple years earlier, the phone rings, and one of my college roommates, fitness guy, runs 3 or 4 miles every day, works out, does his push-ups at night and the sit-ups in the morning, drops dead of a massive heart attack at age 52, leaving behind 2 teenage girls and his wife of 20-some years. Another story. Just 2 years ago, one of my colleagues in Ireland, dinner with his wife, with his 23-year-old daughter in city center Dublin, walks out to a ministry meeting and within 3 minutes has collapsed on the pavement and dies of a massive heart attack. Lord, did you not get the memo? He was a missionary. He was doing your work. This is senseless. Can I trust you with untimely deaths? Another colleague has a 19-year-old son tragically die his freshman year of college a number of years ago in just a freakish of all accidents. A guy that was just the apple of everybody's eye that was going to change the world for the sake of the gospel. How do you make sense of untimely deaths? I struggle with timely deaths. I just don't like death. You know, I was able to sit with one of my first Irish friends a couple years ago in his bedroom as he was finally at the end of his battle with cancer at age 70. He had had a renewed faith had taken place since our time that we had a chance of arriving in Ireland. We've been able to be a part of that and enjoy friendship and camaraderie. And yet, as I looked at Frank at age 70 and just the shell of a man, knowing the Lord was preparing to take him home, I hated it. I hate death in this world, and it tempts me to despair. And when I'm in a place of despair, I'm tempted to want nothing to do with God. Each of you have stories of untimely deaths. This community has faced untimely deaths. Even in the 6 years that I've been gone, I've heard the stories of too many funerals for young people in East Knoxville. Untimely deaths. And I'm sure you hate it as much as I do. You know, death may not be your number one enemy, but you have your enemies. And they come from, you know, whether it's the flesh or the world or Satan. It could be family crisis. It could be health issues. It can be financial pressures, addictions, characteristics that are idols of envy and greed and self-righteousness. Endless possibilities, but you have your enemies. Name them. Name them. For there are enemies that tempt all of us, just like they tempted David to despair. But David named them. Name your enemies today in your heart. And let's now learn from David, what did he do about it? As we move through this psalm, birthed in isolation and persecution, picking up now in verse 3. We hear this declaration of God's character, but you, Lord, are a shield around me, my shield. You, Lord, are my glory, my audience of one. Lord, you are the one who lifts my head on high. You are my lifter, my faithful sustainer. And you answer me from your holy mountain. You rescue me because from the Lord comes deliverance. Yes. The Lord is our deliverer. He's my shield, my glory, my lifter, my answerer, my deliverer. Yes. Pastor might take those five things and run with it in some ways. I'm struggling to clap, dance, and sing at the same time here today, so I'm going to stick with my text here. But do you hear David's declaration of God's character? I'm going to let you in on something here. This is a declaration of fact. I'm going to meddle here a little bit. It's not alternative fact. Sorry, Kellyanne Conway. It's not fake news. Sorry, MSNBC. Forgive me, Lord, for being political here, but no, David is declaring that things are true about God. Verse 3, God is David's shield. You know what a shield is? It's his armor, his buffer, his safeguard, his shelter, his defense, his cover, his security, his shield. David has such faith, such trust in this belief, in this fact that in Psalm 11, verse 1, says he rebukes his enemies and his friends by shouting out the fact that because the Lord is my refuge, how can you tell me to flee like a bird to your mountain because the wicked bend their bows? He mocks those that tempt him to fear his enemies and tells them that the wonderful character of God is his shield. It's his refuge. Continuing in verse 3, God is David's glory. Well, what does that mean? That's one of those religious words. God is David's glory. Well, it means, unlike other men who find glory in fame and in fortune, in reputation and wealth or power, David found his glory in God. Yes. See, David is beholden to this audience of one. Psalm 115, verse 1 says, not to us, Lord, not to us, but to your name be the glory because of your faithfulness and love. David's allegiance is to Almighty God. Where's your glory? What do you worship? What idols have replaced God and become your glory? Still continuing, God has lifted David's head on high, up from his posture of self-pity, of victimization, and of despair, so that he can see God's glory. See, to see God's glory, you've got to get your head up. You've got to get your eyes up and your head up and off of yourself. You know Psalms 121, I lift my eyes to the mountains. My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Lift up your eyes, saints of OBC. Lift them up, for God is your shield. He's your glory, and he's your lifter. And in verse 4b, David declares that God will answer him from his holy mountain because the Lord is his deliverer. No matter the words of Shimei or his own self-doubts, David declares the liberating power of God. God is his liberator, his rescuer, and deliverer. So what does he do next? Look with me here at verse 4a. And you will hear the cry of a dependent heart. I will call out to the Lord, and I will say, arise, Lord, deliver me, God, strike all my enemies on the jaw and break the teeth of the wicked. I like that. I mean, what comes first? Do we declare the character of God and then cry out, or do we cry out and then declare the character of God? I'm a linear guy. I'm like you step through it here. None of this paradox integration mix mash of gray. I just kind of want to show me the recipe. What comes first here? Well, actually, I think it's a both and. See, in the midst of his opposition, David has found a way to get back to God. And he does it through this combination of a verbal lament, of crying out, of prayer and beseeching and pleading. You guys are good at this. I've seen you in action here. But it comes along with declaring characteristics about God that are true. So he could remind himself of God's faithfulness, his love, his all-sustaining sovereignty and power toward him in the midst of facing enemies. See, facing enemies, dealing with persecution, addressing anxiety and fear, digging oneself out of despair, loneliness, self-pity, they require the physical action of yelling at God. The Irish are good at this. They are good at just breaking all the rules. I think they even curse sometimes at God. But not in the same way it sounds around here. It's in Irish. David is yelling here at God, screaming for help. God, I need you to show up, and now would be preferable. We've got to acknowledge our dependency before God, because we are weak, and we are broken, and we are fearful. But we also have the confidence to declare the very character of God as our shield, our glory, our lifter, our rescuer and deliverer. For David was sustained by the grace of Almighty God, and he rested. You know, often our enemies and our places of despair center around the craziest things. Sometimes they're these obvious external things. But a lot of times in my life, there are these kind of subtle things that I call misguided expectations. In other words, this is how we think, this is how Bruce thinks life should work. As one friend of mine that will go unnamed has quoted, says that expectations are actually just preconceived resentments. In other words, God should be working for me the way I expect. And what happens in my life is I've shattered dreams. And unmet expectations become temptations for despair. Do you have any shattered dreams? Any shattered, broken dreams? I had one being shattered my very first few months in Ireland. See, when I asked and invited to come with Kathy to the Republic of Ireland and do mission work, one of the first orders that came my way was, Bruce, can you help rebuild our summer student internship? It's discipleship, missions, evangelism, training, 2-month module for Irish and American university students. It had died out. We'd lost some different connections, and that was like first on my to-do list. Well, the good news was that historically our mission, Surge, had partnered with the equivalent of InterVarsity in Ireland called the International Fellowship of Evangelical Students, IFES, Ireland. And I thought, well, gosh, I'm all set. I've worked with IFES USA for 25 years. I've run summer projects overseas. I've done this every spring here in the States. I had even met the director of IFES Ireland like 10 years earlier on a joint mission trip in Ukraine. His son's name was Aaron. My son's name was Moses. They were born a day apart. Is that not divine intervention? And the stars are lining up here for the greatest ever summer internship program in the history of the country of Ireland, because God's just prepared me. He's given me all the experiences, the know-how. I've got this ace in my hole that this is the thing that's easy for me to do. This is the one sure thing that will go well. So I had a dream, I had an expectation, and I had all my eggs in this basket, and I show up in Ireland, I can't get a hold of the guy who's the director of this mission. He's out of town, and call back, and I'm just beginning, okay. Well, in October, they had a big donor alumni banquet, and I thought, well, I'll just show up at this banquet here. And so I show up at this by myself. I don't know a lot of folks there. And there's alumni from IFES in Ireland and board members. And I kind of catch this director's eye a number of times. He just kind of looks like right through me, doesn't recognize me, looks over at me. And I'm starting to think this thing may fall apart here. And I sit down at one of the banquet tables, and these guys are up front, and they're all like 20 years younger than me. All with about 4 or 5, and they're telling people what IFES is. And I'm thinking, well, I know better what IFES is. and I'm older than you and more experienced, and wow, I just start judging this whole thing, and my self-righteousness just kind of flows through me. And it's like, wow, I'm judge and jury right here on how this evening should go. But about halfway through this presentation, it dawns on me. It takes me a little while to get clued in. This summer internship thing might be a little tougher than I thought. And I might actually get X'd out that when you're an American missionary, you come with limitations. This is their country. This is their program. Who are you showing up here? You're going to fix it? Wow, we love Americans. Come on over and fix us because we're all screwed up. That's the truth. And I'm thinking I'm being low-key. I mean, I'm unassuming. You know, I'm not that hefty-looking of a guy. How can I threaten anybody? And I go through this downward spiral, and I start thinking, what could I do tonight after this banquet to dust my feet from this thing? I think I'll go get a pint of Guinness. I didn't even drink beer. And I'm going to start now. You know, if I'm going to be a missionary in Ireland, I got to learn how to drink beer. And so I get myself thinking, I'm going to get a pint of Guinness. I'm going to walk out to the Haypenny Bridge, and I'm going to stand over the Liffey, and that rain's going to come down, and I'm going to just kind of, you know, kind of like, what was that film with oh, what's his name in the South that's kind of sitting in the ocean, and he's kind of yelling at the storm, you know, of saying, Forrest Gump, I don't know, that whole deal. What's Captain what's his name sitting out there yelling in the thunderstorm? That's me. I'm done with it here. And then I thought I'd move on the next day. Well, somehow, in the middle of this director's presentation, I was convicted. Somehow, I was like, Bruce, what are you doing here? Start declaring the character of God. Get yourself, get your head off of yourself and lift it up. And I cried out to the Lord. I said, give me one chance, Lord, to just shake the guy's hand and say, hi, my name's Bruce, and I'm from America, and I need work to do, and will you help me, or something like that. And after this banquet, I bumped into him, and he looks at me, and he says, Bruce, I saw you were on our list. Thanks for coming. I can't wait to meet with you and talk about what the summer can look like. And 6 years later, we now have a program where the IFES team is officially partnering with our team, and they send staff, and we send staff, and they recruit students, and we recruit students, and all. But in the moment, you lose perspective. We all lose perspective, and we downward spiral. But may God give us the courage to believe that shattered dreams, unmet expectations, that our enemies, whoever they are, may be whisked away in a moment's notice by the power of God as we move from a place of despair to declaring the character of God and crying out to him with dependent hearts. In the midst of struggle, keep your mind stayed on Jesus. Yeah. Well, we're finally here to verse 5. And this is the keynote verse in this text here. We're going to talk about the grace of dependencies being sustained and at rest. Verse 5, I lie down and sleep, and I wake again because the Lord sustains me. It goes on, I will not fear. And then at the end of this psalm, David says, may your blessings be on your people. There's two graces here I want you to see that David receives in the midst of his dependency on Almighty God. The first grace is sleep. Remember Psalm 4? He has this peaceful sleep, and peace I'll lie down. It's a grace that David is sleeping. In spite of his intense emotional pain, anxiety, fear, despair of Absalom's conspiracy, attempts to take his life, David slept. Unbelievable. I mean, he laid down and he went to sleep. I mean, how many of us lay down in our heads, you know, thinking about tomorrow, what didn't get done, this person thinks this of me, and what did they say on TV, you know, all that stuff. David lays down and he sleeps. So God gives him rest and renewal. This grace was given to him as he submitted himself in dependence on God. The second grace was he woke up the next morning. And he might not have wanted to wake up the next morning. But the grace of waking up was because many wondered if David would live to see a new day. I mean, to see another day was not to be taken for granted for David. And it's exclusively and only because God is David's sustainer that he's given first the grace of rest and then the grace to live another day. See, God's not done with David. He's not done with you. God has a purpose for him as he does for us as David awakens to face his enemies. I mean, he's not even getting up to kind of take a day off here. He's waking in the midst of opposition. God sustains us in our sleep. But we take it for granted, don't we? I mean, think of it. You're asleep. You're unconscious. You're dead to the world. Yet you're breathing. How are you doing that? I mean, your heart's pumping. Are you making that happen? I mean, your organs are all operating. Do you kind of like go through your checklist to make sure that's all happening? No. The same God who sustains us in our sleep now wakes us for another day. And with the same power that took you through the night, he will sustain you in your difficulties and your sufferings and your enemies of opposition. It's so easy for Kathy and me to forget the ways God has sustained us. When we first prepared to go to Ireland 7 years ago, one of the concerns was they had kicked out a bunch of missionaries and they were only allowing missionaries to stay for 3 years. And so people would say to us, well, what are you going to do if you get kicked out? And I said, oh gosh, I hadn't thought about that. I guess we'd go to a plan B maybe, but I'm not a contingency kind of guy. So I said, we'll just worry about that later. But why would we go if we might have to come back in 3 years? Well, of course, we felt called by God, been confirmed by God. You know, there's a little bit of adrenaline in a big step like this. So you're kind of, you know, minimizing the things that might go. At least Kathy might be on the flip side. But, I mean, I would minimize things. And so we balance each other out. Kathy helps us be aware of things that we might want to think about. And so the Lord's made us a team, but both of us were convinced we'd been called to Ireland by God and trusted he would provide the means for us to stay. So what happened? Well, after 3 years, we had to fill out this long appeal form and send in references and documentation to stay a fourth year. And we waited and we checked the mail every day. Well, it shows up and the Irish naturalization immigration office said you can stay another year, stay out of trouble, no criminal kind of, you know, marks against you, pay your taxes, those kind of things. Well, then we did this for a fifth year. Of course, this process means getting a taxi at 4 a.m, getting driven down to the city center, standing in a line with all these immigrants that are like 30 years younger than you from all parts of the world, And it was good for us. I mean, it gave us an appreciation of what it means to live as an alien. I hated it. I wouldn't want to ever do it again, but we went through it. We got our 5th-year stamp. Well, then we got our 6th-year. Well, now, since we've been living in Ireland 5 years, we could apply for citizenship. We kind of move through this citizenship application process. We get approved before we come back this past summer. Kathy and I are holding Irish passports now. I mean, who, praise God. I mean, who could ever have imagined an amazing story? And yet, in a heartbeat, we can forget that there was a season we had no idea whether we could stay more than 3 years. It's like, I've ticked that box. Give me some more sustaining grace, Lord. And then I forget how powerful and amazing it is. If I'd known 7 years ago, oh yeah, and we'll have our Irish citizenship in 2017 based on blah, blah, blah. We don't know the future, do we? We just walk in step as the Lord calls us. For just like David, Kathy and I have been sustained and rest in the grace of Almighty God. As we live in a posture of dependency, declaring his character and crying out to the Lord, deliver us. I started the word this morning with the question, do you sleep well at night? Well, here's a tip. Tell yourself over and over personal stories, experiences that remind you of the ways that God's sustaining grace has carried you in your life. Write it down, journal it, tell it to your spouse, to your roommate, to your children. Stories such that will help you never forget that you've been sustained by God and you can rest in this grace of dependency in light of his faithfulness to you. I mean, it's crazy. People look at Kathy and me, oh, you guys are super Christians. See, missionaries are super Christians. Did you know that? You know, we're like cut, a different kind of cut here. I mean, only super Christians, you know, sell their homes and raise financial support and go somewhere as an alien and think people are going to be interested in hearing what you have to say, and you keep your marriage together and everything's perfect with your family. I mean, we have the perfect family, you know? I think it might be the only one in America, you know, where we don't have any problems, you know? I mean, that's what people think sometimes. You probably think that of your pastor here. He's not perfect. He and Lady Arnold have actually argued with each other before. Not as much as probably Kathy and me, but we forget, Kathy and I forget how we've been sustained, our call from 7 years ago is continuing till today. Our family, we like to talk to each other. You know, our marriage after 30 years and a little bit of counseling and a little bit of fighting and a lot of love is still being held together by God's grace. Yeah, our finances have worked out. Our ministry has been a joy. It's unbelievable, and yet, even with all of what I've experienced these last 6 years, and I'm going to finish with this one last story. God had to shake me in November and say, Bruce, you're still not remembering that even your very breath is given to you by me. I'd gone out and run this 5K race with my family in the D.C. area. My sister had recovered from cancer, a beautiful, crisp, clear day at a great race. We're all going to go to this pancake house for breakfast and just kind of celebrate. It's kind of one of those special moments where the stars are all lined up. And I get out of the car with Kathy to go into the pancake house, and I don't have my wallet. Now, that's not unusual. I mean, I lose it all the time, but I know I haven't really lost it. You know, it's like I kind of know we're going to find it. But in the moment, there's a little bit of a panic. But I'm not panicked at this point. because I thought, you know, we had pulled into another diner earlier that was too crowded, and I remember switching out my trousers to some sweatpants, and I had to take my wallet out. It's going to be lying there in the pavement, you know, at that diner. Kathy's like, well, someone's going to steal your wallet. I said, no one's stealing my wallet. Why do that for? People don't do that kind of thing. You know, they'll just let the wallet stay there or they'll turn it in. No one's going to take my wallet. So we drive back to the parking lot where this diner is, and I go over to look at the spot, and I'm down. It's like, I'm sure it's here, Kathy. Hang on, you know. And someone must have picked it up, and they took it inside the diner. So I go into the diner, and I go up to the hostess. I said, I think someone has brought you my wallet. Where would it be? And she, let me check the lost and found. And she goes back, and we don't have any wallet. I say, well, do you have another lost and found? Can I talk to your manager? Because I'm sure I left my wallet in this parking lot, and someone must have. She said, no, sir, we do not have your wallet. So I walk back outside. I'm starting to get a little nervous at this point, and a woman is now in my same former parking space pulling out. She must have seen my wallet. So I, ma'am, did you see my wallet? And she kind of looks at me, and I said, no, my wallet. And she's kind of, no, really, seriously, did you? No, sir. And she kind of gets in her car and locks it and, you know, kind of pulls off. So now I'm getting a little dangerous. And for the first time, I'm thinking I've lost my wallet. It's got my Irish driver's license, my American driver's license, my Visa card, my you name it, it's in there, right? And someone probably tried to call me. So I get my phone. The person who has my wallet certainly saw my business card. And no calls, but there's an email. And so I open up my email, and the subject line says, SOS, you lose you document. Well, this sounds intriguing. And so I open up the email. It says, hello, my name is Yadir Sarvia. Please call me. I have you something you lose. And I can't explain because I speak very little English. So I dial the phone number, and Yadir answers it, but we can't really talk to each other because he doesn't speak very good English. And he hands the phone to a passerby who tells me this man is holding a wallet for Bruce Allwood because my business card. I said, well, great, you must be right around the corner. Where are you? He says, well, we're at Walmart. I said, Walmart? Well, that's 3 miles down the road. I said, stay there. I'll be there in a minute. So we hop in the car. We drive the 3 miles to Walmart. I get out of the car looking for a Yadir. And so I see a guy that looks like a Yadir sitting on the park bench. And I accost him, and do you have my wallet? And he said, no. And it was a Walmart employee. And so then Yadir comes out of the Walmart holding my wallet. And he comes up to me, and we hug like long-lost friends. And he's managed to kind of sort my wallet in a way that's never been sorted before. It was wonderful. And I said to Yadir, how did you find me? And he shows on me on his iPhone a picture of me and my family on Facebook. He had found my name and Facebook, and he was comparing the picture to make sure I was the real person to get this wallet. And I say, thank you so much. Did you find this in the parking space of the last diner? He said, oh, no. I said, what do you mean? Oh, no. Well, I was driving behind you on Route 7, which is like a 6-lane divided highway, and your wallet flows off of the roof into the highway. And he asked me, do you have a baby? I mean, he was giving me the benefit of the doubt. You must have been distracted or something. And so my wallet goes across 3 lanes with dollar bills and credit cards and whatever. And this fella, Yadir, turns around and goes and gathers all my stuff. I mean, how many times have I driven by? I mean, how many times have we driven by someone who's in trouble and said, oh, gosh, poor guy. Hope God bless you, you know? And I will never, ever again drive by someone whose wallet's fallen off their car into the road and not turn around and go get it. Yater gathers up my wallet, drives to Walmart, gets on Facebook, messages me and calls me. I felt like I'd just been given salvation. I mean, I'd just been, it's like, you know, your life's back. We've got photographs now of me and Yater smiling, you know, holding the wallet. And here's the truth. He was an immigrant from Honduras. I didn't ask him. I wouldn't be surprised if he was an illegal immigrant, which for some of us in some of our circles are like, how can you be that kind of a person to break the law, right? And here I am. I'm saved by an illegal alien from Honduras who can't speak English, changed my life that day. I went to the pancake house. I bought everybody breakfast, you know? I mean, it's like, here's my credit card. Just order right here. The reason I finish with, I call this a high-end miracle. Are there high-end? I don't know. This was high-end to me. I mean, this was like unexplainable. You can't draw it up. God just said, Bruce needs a lot of help today. I'm going to deliver him. But the reason why, see, that picture, it's kind of like how I live every day of my life. I just sometimes don't realize it. That was obvious, but every day of my life, God is delivering me. He's helping me. But many times we miss it. And unless it's high end or extraordinary or this is worth testifying in front of the church, we don't count it. That's just regular stuff. God's sustaining us even in our sleep is not regular stuff. It's the foundation of him delivering us. Psalm 116 says, "Return to your rest, my soul, for the Lord's been good to you." Psalm 31 says, "My times are in your hands. Deliver us from the hands of my enemies. Let your face shine on your servant. Save me, sustain me in your unfailing love." Kind of wish I had some, well, we got wine right here. This is probably non-alcoholic. Yeah, this is, we're not in Ireland. No non-alcoholic wine in Ireland. It's Super Bowl Sunday, it might be. But I tell you, I would want to make a toast today, and we're taking communion here soon, to a peaceful sleep tonight. A new day of purpose unto God's glory tomorrow for all of us. May we live in this truth that just like David, we're sustained and rest in the grace of Almighty God. And before I close in prayer and as the worship team prepares to play a tune that really ties in with our sermon here of trusting in you, I just want to offer two invitations today. Some of you guys here today, there's something about the worship time, the word preached, maybe just a certain thought that you've been sitting on at the last 20 minutes while I've moved on, and you've just recognized you need to be renewed. You need to make a renewed commitment that the Lord your God is your shield and your glory, your deliverer, your lifter, your rescuer. And from this day forward, you have to say, I'm coming back, Lord. I may have been backslidden, or I've just been a little dry, or I've just been a little bit focused with my head down, thinking I need to be in control. And you need to come forward, and we need to pray for you to say, yes, Lord, today you will be my everything. And the second invitation is for anyone here who you're not sure how you showed up this morning. You're not sure how you got into these seats. And you've got some white middle-aged guy up preaching who spent time in Ireland and this dynamic black worship team that puts out a schedule and then just kind of rips it up before the service begins, to trust your spirit
and you see something you like, because the Lord is saying, today's your day. It's your day with David to say, I'm not going to wallow or hide out in a cave and try to pick myself up by the bootstraps. But I'm going to say, yes, Lord, you are my everything. So if you're in any of those two situations today, please come forward. And pastor's here, and I'll be here, and there's a prayer team, and there'll be folks that will pray for you as pastor leads us in worship.
Everyone stand. What a phenomenal word. Phenomenal. Phenomenal. Well, that's the worst thing you could do is to be given the opportunity to receive such a great gift and not respond in some way. And so if you're thirsty, if you need somebody just to pray for you and believe God for you, this is the time. Don't die of thirst sitting right in front of the river. So everybody that needs God to do something fresh for you, this is not just about getting saved. This is not about being saved. You want to be saved, you come. But everybody that's needing God to do something fresh for them, you just need to start over. You need to drink. You need a fresh start with God. And there's a sense of a callous on your heart. I need you to move right now. Move really quickly. Let's get prayer. Let's get prayer. Thank you so much, y'all. Come, move quickly. Move quickly. Move quickly. Move quickly. Move quickly. Bruce, go on up. Go on up. They want them to pray for you. Move quickly. Move quickly. Move quickly. You don't have to wait in line. You can come all the way across if you would like. Move quickly. Everybody else, I want you to grab somebody's hand really quickly. Mother, Papa, I need y'all to help me, please. It's got several people here. I need, for those of you who operate in prayer and intercessors, I need you to help me, please.
Letting go of every single dream, lay each one down at your feet.
Everybody else, I want you to close your eyes. Perhaps you're in this place, you're not 100% sure that you're saved and you want to go to heaven. And you're not exactly sure if you were to die right now, you would even go to heaven. Today is the day of salvation. Now is the appointed time. God wants to save you today. Or perhaps you want to join this ministry and you sense that this is the place that you can grow and be built up in the faith. When I count to three, I want you to squeeze somebody's hand saying, hey, I want to be saved, or I want to join this ministry, or I want to come under watch care, if that's you. When I count to three and you're still in that congregation, I want you just to squeeze somebody's hand. Father, in the name of Jesus, I give you praise for this day. I honor you and I bless you for the word that went forth. I pray, God, that you would use us for your glory, that you, O Lord, would speak into the lives of those that are here. There be somebody in this place that not 100% sure that you're saved. Save them as only you can do. Save them. Restore them. Bring them to this ministry so we can teach them the things of God. My brothers and sisters, if you're in this place and you're not 100% sure that you're saved, you don't know if you're going to heaven or hell, today is the day of salvation. Now is the appointed time. Doesn't matter what you've done wrong last year or last month or last week or last night, God will save you today if you want to be saved. So when I count to three, if I'm talking to you, if you're in one of those three categories, I just want you to squeeze somebody's hand that's standing beside you saying, I need to be saved, or I need to be restored, or I need to join this ministry. If that's you, when I count to three, I want you to squeeze that hand as tight as you can. One, don't let the enemy keep you bound another day of your life. Two, pride cometh before destruction and a haughty heart before a great fall. Three, if I'm talking to you, squeeze that hand right now. Squeeze that hand right now. Father, I've done all I can do. No man can come unless he be drawn by you. If somebody squeezed your hand, I want you to lift that hand straight up in the air. Lift it up all over the building. I see you, I see you, I see you, I see you. Even if you didn't lift somebody's hands, I want you to lift it up if I'm talking to you. Now, if somebody lifted up your hand or you lifted theirs, I want you to bring them to this altar right now. Just bring them so we can pray for them. Let's finish the deal. Come on. Come on. Bring them with you. Bring them with you. Come on. Come on. Come on. Bring them with you.
You are my foundation.
Bring them with you.
The rock of which
bring them with you. I see you.
Your ways are
always higher. Go get my brother. Amen.
Your plans are always good.
Amen.
There's not a place where I go. You've not already
deacons, if you all would help me pray for the people. We got several people that need prayer. If you could just help me, please. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. I wish I could walk through when you don't give me answers as I cry out to you.
Anybody else you need prayer, just come.
I will trust, I will trust, I will trust
Nicole,
in you.
If you would help me pray, please.
I will trust in you. I will trust in you. Trust in you.
Yes, God.
When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust. Trust in you. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. I cry.
you to celebrate what God has done on today. Would you do that for me? Now I want you to celebrate the gift that the Lord has sent us in Bruce Allwood and his beautiful family. Come on, let's give him a great OBC. Thank you, Jesus, for coming. What a day it has been. What a day it has been. The anointing of God is so strong in this place. I thank you all for your maturity. I thank you all for receiving. And I don't know about you, but my life is transformed because of the word of God that was spoken.